Alrighty, looks like we've got some ladies from Breakout that are coming back into our big group. I hope you guys enjoyed the Breakout session and got to know each other. And don't be shy. This is what we're here for, is to build our network and get to know one another and have a great time this morning learning. So I hope you guys got a chance to enjoy that. It looks like I think we have everyone back in as our in our big group. Yes, we do. Fantastic. Okay, so now I'm going to mix it up a little bit more, and I'm going to hope that you don't get the same group. My intention is to do this totally random so you can get a chance to meet as many ladies as you can this morning. So again, for the new ladies that joined us a little bit later, we have two breakout sessions before the speaker, and it's just a chance to just get to know each other and have a good time. So I am going to now break you out for the second breakout time, and that'll be the final one before we get started with the program. So again, I hope that you don't get the same ladies because I want you to get a chance to meet everyone, but I'm going to do a random selection here. So if you do get the same ladies, just dig a little deeper and get to know her even more. So here we go. Let me break you guys out. Let's see here. Okay, y'all have fun. Here we go. Good morning, ladies. If you are just now joining us, thank you so much for being here. We're going to have an awesome morning. I just wanted to let you know that our ladies are currently in breakout sessions for networking. We have two sessions that we run before the program starts. We are on our session two so that the ladies can get to know each other a little bit better. So if you're just now joining us, just hang tight. They'll be in there for about another 3 minutes and then I'll bring them back and then we'll have the big group together. So again, thank you so much for being here. I'm so happy to have you and we're gonna have an awesome morning. So just hang tight just for a few moments while those ladies are in breakout sessions and then we will bring the group back and we'll get started. So hope you guys are having a great morning.
Thank you, good morning.
Good morning, good morning. You are so welcome. I'm super excited. Today's speaker is gonna be awesome. Awesome, 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 which they always are awesome, but I'm kind of biased because I like them all. But anyway, glad you guys are here. It looks like Miss Glenda just joined us. Miss Belinda just joined us. So if you didn't get a chance to hear me just a moment ago, ladies, the ones that just joined, we are currently in breakout networking sessions. They've got just a few more minutes left with this for the second session. So I'll be bringing them back to the big group and then we'll get our program started. So just hang tight and I'll be right back with you guys. But thank you so much for joining us. All right, girls, we've got about 5 seconds and it looks like all of our ladies should join us.
Okay, we're doing 10.
Yeah, okay, we are at 7:58, ladies, so we are going to turn it over at this time. And we'll get started here in just a few minutes, right at 8 o'clock. And Ms. Donna Lisa on the other end on our campus side is going to do our introduction. So just give us a few moments and we'll get started.
So we're already recording, I see that, so that's good. And I'm gonna go ahead and share it out live. And hi, Peggy, I sent you a message and said, good morning, it's so nice to see you.
And just as a few housekeeping rules, ladies that are here virtually, as we go through the presentation, if there are any questions you guys have, please message me privately so I can get all of those questions together. And then at the end of the presentation, we're going to do a Q&A where we will alternate questions between our virtual ladies and our ladies on campus so that we can answer as many questions as we possibly can. So just remember to send me a chat privately and I will be collecting all of those questions and asking those at the end of the session. And on another note, just for housekeeping, we do have closed caption available. If anyone wants to initiate that, we do have it available and you can turn that on your end. So please feel free to do that if need be. Thank you so much. We'll get started in just a second.
Okay, good morning, everyone. We are so excited to see you here this morning. Thank you so much for taking the time this morning and showing up for Women Rise. We are so excited about the program that we're having, and we're very excited about the fact that we can not only bring you this virtually, but also in person. So for those of you that are here in person, please make yourself at home, eat, enjoy. Our house is your house. So we are the Center for Women Entrepreneurs. We were funded by the state legislature in 2015 to help women in the state of Texas start and grow their business. And the Center for Women Entrepreneurs is part of the Jane Nelson Institute for Women's Leadership. So this entire floor is the Jane Nelson. So if you have a chance when you're done, take a walk to the right outside the door and check out the if the doors are closed, you can't go in, but this whole floor is the Jane Nelson, and we're so excited that we're able to be up here and provide and give you Women Rise up here in person. So the Jane Nelson Institute for Women's Leadership at Texas Women's University is dedicated to preparing more women to take on successful roles in business and public service. It's 3 specialized centers, the Center for Student Leadership, the Center for Women Entrepreneurs, and the Center for Women in Politics and Public Policy. Ensure women have the education to establish careers as successful C-suite executives, the skills for building entrepreneurial businesses, and the framework needed to run for public office. Yes, I had to read that because it's a mouthful. So Tracy Irby is the director of the Center for Women Entrepreneurs, and she's out of town right now. And so she sends her welcome and thank you for being here. Before we get started, I'd like to take a minute and introduce our staff. So we have Barbara Reinke. She is our program coordinator. She is virtual with us. She's handing our Facebook Live and helping Stephanie there on our virtual component. We also have Stephanie Robinson. She's our small business advisor. She is also virtual. And Stephanie, I think you have some fans here that want to meet you in person one day. So maybe one day we can do Rise here and you can do it virtual in one of the back offices.
That sounds great.
We also have Kimberly Nielsen. She is our statewide program manager. And she will be responsible for extending the arm of the Center for Women Entrepreneurs in and around the state of Texas. And then for those of you that parked in the visitor parking lot, we had Rebecca Vasquez. She is the JNIWL admin assistant, and she was nice enough to come in this morning and help us out. And so what we're going to do now As a reminder, when you registered, you filled out you answered the question on whether you wanted your information to be shared with everybody else. So we will send that list out for everybody that said yes, you'll get the list. So right now, what we're gonna do is our online community is going to introduce themselves inside of the chat, and we will download the text chat, and we will also include that in the resources. So our virtual audience will have access to our in-person audience, and our in-person audience will have access to our virtual audience. So they're gonna put their stuff in the chat, and what we're gonna do is we're gonna go quickly around the room. If you'll introduce yourself, your name and your business, and the overhead mics do pick up that information, so you don't have to worry about saying it too loud or that kind of stuff. We have that great technology. I'll start because I realized I didn't introduce my own self. I'm Annalisa Stinyard, and I'm the program director here at the Center for Women Entrepreneurs. So I think we started on this side last time, so we'll start on this side this time. We'll start with you.
My name is Michelle Holloway. My business is Lifestyle Transitions, and I'm a mobile outpatient, a concierge occupational therapist. I focus on fall prevention for the 65 and older population.
Okay, perfect.
I'm Cynthia Adeola, which is open to Haiti Wellness of Denton. I am an alternative medicine practitioner.
I'm Shakita Owens. I am the owner of Abundant Health Counseling. I'm a licensed professional counselor, and my focus is on trauma and obesity and bariatrics.
Right here.
My name is Carrie Carruthers. I work for TM Appraisals in town. I'm training to be a licensed appraiser, but spent many years in printing and marketing industry.
Awesome.
I'm Olivia Jeffers, and I am running for Justice of the Peace, Precinct 1. Karen Denton.
Nice.
My name is Carla Levinson. I'm the Director of Sales at the Spring Hill Suites in Denton, and we have meeting space if you need it.
Marge Atkinson with Ask Marge. I do research for businesses, authors, and mostly grad students. If you haven't found what you're looking for, ask Marge.
Awesome. Alice, we'll go back there with you.
Oh, I'm Alice Huff. I currently teach at North Central Texas College of Nursing, and I'm looking for my next career opportunity.
Okay.
I'm Ann Morgeson. I retired as a teacher last year and now a full-time health coach.
I'm Kendra Thorpe, and I'm with Kendra Thorpe Consulting, and I just help beautiful women prosper.
Okay. Hi, I'm Eileen. I work with Auburn Hills here at the center. We do luncheons, seminars, so if you need another meeting space, you do.
<That's true. laughs> And I'm Jenna Howard. I also work with Auburn Hills.
Hello, good morning, everyone. My name is Cindy Erk, and I own CM Promotions. We're a wedding and event planning company throughout DFW, and I'm excited to be here.
Hi, I'm Sherry Traylor, and I own Tuati Designs. We do screen printing and specialize in nonprofits and fundraising.
Hi, I'm Jody Snow. I own Calculate, a bookkeeping company, and at Calculate, we help you keep your numbers straight.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much. And I would be remiss if I did not say to Hawthorne Hills, congratulations again on winning the Denton Chamber's Women in Business. Again, we're so glad to have you here. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce today's speaker, Heather Steele, Blue Steel Solutions. So Heather's mantra is no one cares about your business. Seriously, not even your mama. She's on a mission to help brands focus their content and messaging on what really matters, the problems they solve for their customers. Heather is the CEO of Blue Steel Solutions and creator of the Problem Solver Method. She started her agency 11 years ago because she was tired of seeing great companies and great people fail just because they couldn't clearly communicate. Heather and her team help organizations create clear, concise, and actionable marketing messages through consulting, website services, and premium ebooks and templates. We're so excited to have Heather here again. She's spoken for us several times, and we're just so grateful that she is always willing to provide insight and her experience with our community. So Heather, and let me get you shared out. So
my timer changed, so I don't talk for too long.
Stephanie, can we see that okay?
Yes, we can.
Well, good morning. Nice to see you all here. I see a few familiar faces, so welcome back if we've met before. So today we're going to be talking about generating and converting leads, and I'm going to do my best throughout to kind of try to apply this conversation to all of your different business types and the goals that you have inside of your businesses. But really what we're talking about is generating interest around your business and then getting those people to actually buy, because that's kind of the most important thing that we can do in our businesses, right? Is generate some revenue. So. All right, so I'm Heather Steele. I'm the founder and CEO of Blue Steel Solutions. I realize I need to update my profile because this has actually been 12 years now, almost to the date. I started my business 5 days after my son was born, and his birthday was on July 2nd. So we've been doing this for 12 years now. And created several sub companies to basically help people at all steps of their business journey to get the resources they need to be able to grow, attract the right prospects, and increase their revenue. So let's face it, finding and converting leads to customers is really hard work, right? If it was easy, then anyone could do it and we would all be millionaires by now. So I want to start with introducing the idea of the sales funnel. And you guys have probably seen this before, but if not, I just want to get us all on the same page with what a sales funnel is, because I'll be talking about this throughout. And this is a very, very, very simplified version of a sales funnel. Everyone's will look different depending on your business. But basically we have to generate leads. We have to get people interested. We have to get them interacting with us. We have to somehow get a hold of their contact information so we can be really proactive in marketing to them and interacting with them. And then we need to move them to close. So this is the process of getting all of the right information in front of them to make them ready to buy. And then we need to get paid. That's an important part of the funnel that some people don't talk about. You know, we've talked about moving people to close, but especially if you are in a service-oriented business, or you do maybe work that's invoiced and not necessarily paid through a checkout, it's a really important step that sometimes we feel like we've won the deal and then we never get paid on it. So I want to make sure that we focus on that as well today. So let's start with generating leads. So what does it mean? Oh, this thing is very sensitive, y'all. You're just going to have to bear with me. We might be going a little back and forth. So what does it mean to generate leads? Before we can actually call someone a lead, and there's a lot of different vernacular around leads, prospects, you know, whatever this term is that you're using, but it's basically people that know about your business, are interested or have shown some sort of interest in your products or services, and have given you their contact information. You have a way to connect with them. Now, in some businesses, you might consider a lead like a list of people that you've purchased. I don't always consider that because I think that's a little above a lead. To me, a lead is really someone who's reached out and said, that looks cool. I think I might want that, right? So before we can do that, we've got to generate awareness and interest. We have to know that we exist. It's a really important part of getting people interested. And then we're going to push them to some sort of engagement. And we'll talk more tactically here in a second about this. But let's say that I'm considering this event as a lead generation opportunity. If I don't get your business card or get your information or get you to download something off my website or do something, right, that's going to create an engagement and get your information into my possession, then I haven't really done my job of generating leads. And that's where I think a lot of times people sort of lose track of what the purpose is of all the different lead generating things they're doing, right? They say, well, you know, they went to my website or they liked my post or we talked at this event, but they don't take that next step to actually get that person engaged and make sure they can take control of the conversation. It's really important. And then you need to start building your solution story. And so we're going to kind of sprinkle some content methodology in throughout today's conversation. But when we're looking to get people interested, to make them want to learn more about our business, we need to start building a story for them around the problem that they face that we can solve. And the more specific and granular that we can make that so that it really feels like we're telling a specific person exactly what problem we can solve for them, then the better job we can do of getting their interest, you know, turning them into a lead and then being able to eventually turn them into a buyer. And like I said, we'll talk more about that, but keep in mind that it's all about the solution that you provide to people. And then once we've done all of this work and they said, here's my information, I'd love to stay in touch with you. I'd love to learn more. Give me your ebook. I'm going to, you know, fill out this form on your website or attend your event. Then we consider those people converted to a lead, right? So there's a lot of work that goes ahead of just calling someone a new lead for our business. So let's talk about some of the things that work for that. Social media, right? Social media should be at the top of all of our lists when it comes to generating leads. It's mostly free, right? It costs our time and effort, but we can connect with millions of people online through social media. And I won't have time today to get into the specifics of that, unfortunately, but I will say that really knowing who it is that you're trying to sell to and where they spend their time online is going to be the best way to use social media. Don't try to feel like you need to be everywhere, right? You're going to burn yourself out. You're going to feel exhausted. You're going to say, this social media crap does not work because I am on every platform and nobody's interested. Instead, go deep on one platform. Figure out where you think you can connect most with your audience and go as deep as you can into that platform. Really invest in one place first and feel like you have tried that and you understand it and you've connected with people and you're starting to see results of that work coming back into your business before you add another platform, right? It's very tempting to see like the shiny object of what's going on TikTok, right? And be like, oh, I need to get on TikTok. But if your people hang out on Instagram and you haven't conquered Instagram yet, you don't have any business working on TikTok, right? It's just, you need to focus in one place, go as deep as you can there before you add another one. For both your time and efforts and also just your mental health, you will drive yourself crazy trying to do it all. The second thing we can do and should be doing in our businesses to generate leads is paid ads. Now, not all of us have a lot of budget for ads, but even with as little as $100 a month, you can really start to test content, test audiences, see what resonates with people, and start getting some results. You can advertise on especially Facebook and Instagram very inexpensively. Doesn't mean you're gonna pay $100 and get, you know, 100 times ROI, right? But you can start running some ads to target specific audiences and test content to see what resonates with people. What are they interested in? You get great metrics back off of that. You can really see what's working for you and what's not. And it's a great way to take what would have been, you know, 20 to 40 hours of your time on regular organic social media, trying to connect with people and put your brand right in front of the right people for very little ad spend. So don't feel like paid ads are too expensive or you're not there yet or you're not ready. Really think about your time investment when it comes to all the other things you can do to be generating interest versus if you make a small investment in something like paid ads. A lot of times you'll find that making that investment to get a faster result, faster information back is going to make much more sense than spending all of this time trying to kind of figure out how to get in front of people organically on social media. And then at the end of the day, figure out that now you're no longer really doing your business. You've become a social media expert because you spent so much time trying to figure out how to sell through social media. Another thing that works is SEO. So search engine optimization, if you have a great website, you know, starting to build some SEO sort of in the background of everything else you're doing will bring you very good long-term results. Again, I don't have time today to go into the specifics of how to do SEO on your website, but fortunately, there's about a million articles on the internet and videos, and much smarter people than me will tell you exactly what to do. But the thing to keep in mind with SEO is that you will not get immediate results, right? So if you start looking at how to optimize your content, the right things to be doing, you're not going to see an immediate payback. What you'll see is this slow and gradual increase in the number of people coming to your website and engaging with you. But the cool thing is the work that you do will continue to work for you over time, right? With paid ads, it's like you pay money, you get in front of people, you stop paying money, you stop getting in front of people. But with the effort you put into really optimizing your website, that effort continues on and on. I have products on my website that we sell that I haven't touched in years. We haven't changed the pages. We've maybe updated the content if it needed to just be revised to be relevant now, but we make money off of those products because we put the time and effort into SEO back in the day, and now it just continues to pay off over and over. So it's just something to keep in the back of your mind when you're looking at the cost and expense and time that goes into all of these ways to generate interest in your business. SEO is one that really will pay off over the long. Direct outreach is something that I think we, I hate to generalize, but I think sometimes we as women are a little more hesitant to do direct outreach when it comes to our business. And I'm speaking from my own experience and from the women that I've worked with, but we tend to be a little like this about our businesses, and a little, especially until we feel like we've figured it out and we know what we're doing. And I'll say I've been doing this for 12 years, and there's days when I feel like I still haven't figured it out and I still don't know what I'm doing. And so I kind of get like this about it. But reaching out to people and telling them what we do, talking about our businesses, talking about those problems that we solve for people, being loud about it is really important to generating interest. We cannot sit back and be quiet. We have to reach out to people. If we know we have a solution for someone, like I heard three times in this room already, this people talking about fashion, what to wear, what they like, what they don't like. I can't find stuff. Like, where'd you get that shirt? Because I never can find anything I like. If there is a stylist in this room, I hope you will stand up and go find those people and say, hey, I am a stylist. I can make it work for you. Let's set up a consult. Right? Don't be shy about those things. Reach out to the people you know you can help, because they have problems and they want you to solve those problems. And that kind of overlaps into networking, right? We need to use these opportunities to talk to people about what we do and the problems we solve. And it's, hang on a second. I think I'm gonna rearrange these slides just a little bit. We'll come back to this. So the reason it's so important to be so vocal about those problems that you solve for your business is because, like we said in the introduction, no one cares about your business. Seriously, not even your mama. So what do people care about? They care about winning. They care about getting solutions to the problems that are holding them back in life. So let's go back to that fashion example, right? If I wake up every morning and I feel really uncomfortable in the clothes I'm in, I don't feel like what I'm wearing represents me well. I just feel really like, oh, people are going to look at me and think I'm dressing too young for my age, or this isn't going to be right for the event I'm going to. And I don't know, like, do these shoes go with jeans and a red shirt? I really don't know. I think they do, but who knows, right? This is something that takes up time and energy and space in my life, and I just don't want to have to worry about it. It's a problem. But if someone comes in with the right solution to that problem, immediately, I am going to trust them. I'm going to want to work with them. I'm going to want to give them my money to take care of my problems. And too often we spend our time talking about our businesses, but not talking about those problems. I'm going to back up to this other slide, which I wish I had put these in the other word, but I'll change it for the next one. So what are the things that don't work, right? Being quiet about your business will never get you more business. Just because you're doing stuff and you're making great things, if no one knows about it, and no one knows about it in the context of the problems you solve, then they aren't going to do anything, right? So if you say, I'm a counselor, okay, great. Like, what does that mean? But when you say specifically, I work with people that are suffering from trauma and obesity, and I help them figure out the root of that and work through it so that they can have the freedom to live life and love their bodies for who they are. Now I'm thinking either that's me or that's my friend or that's my sister, and I need to get this girl in contact with them because she's gonna solve their problem, right? So we have to be very vocal and tell people so that they can repeat that for us and that we can create those emotional connections. The other problem is, you know, we feel uncomfortable repeating ourselves, but marketing is an act of repetition. So when you're working on those social media posts, when you're talking to people, don't feel like you have to be clever and rework your verbiage every single time. You need to figure out that little pitch of what problem you solve and say it over and over and over and over and over again. You're going to feel like it's repetitive. No one else will. No one else is going to notice. They're just going to think you're really good at marketing because they understand what you do. Failing to talk about the problem you solve. So we just talked about that. When you talk about your business in generic terms, what you do, it means nothing. But when you talk about those problems you solve for people, it means everything. And then refusing to narrow your audience and your offering. So if we're trying to go too big, we're saying, I work with everyone, right? We're not narrowing that down. Then it becomes harder to frame our offering around a problem that we solve. So really narrowing down who we're selling to and what we're selling. And again, I struggle with this. I have four different businesses now because I struggle with this, so I get it. But trying to create a very specific offering that solves a problem for a very specific group of people will get you so much farther than trying to be a generic one size fits all for a big audience. All right, let's skip past these again. Okay, so I want you, when you're writing posts, talking about your business, putting together anything for marketing, I want you to do what I call the who cares test, right? So if you write something or you're gonna say something or you're gonna create a new offering or anything in your business, I want you to ask yourself, who cares? And if you're the only one that cares, don't do it. If your target customer cares, then do it, right? It's that simple. But sometimes we have to stop and really use this who cares test to make sure that what we're doing aligns with the people we're trying to sell to. That's going to make our businesses easier to run, so much more fun to run. We're going to work with the right people, and our messaging is going to be super effective. I know I'm moving really fast here because I have a lot to talk about in a very short period of time, but I'm going to stick around for questions. So if y'all have any, write them down, and I can clarify things later. So the next stage of our sales funnel, once we've done the work of getting that contact, we know that they want more from us, we know they might be interested, now we need to move them to close. And this is where I see so many people fall off, right? We get someone on our newsletter list, we get them to an event, we do whatever it is to get their interest and to get contact with them. And then we're just like, okay, I hope you buy, goodbye. I'm gonna go hide over here and pretend I don't have a business. But when we do that, we are leaving so much on the table. So we've got to nurture, educate, and convince our prospects that they can trust us and that they want to buy from us. So what works? Social media, again, right? Once we make that initial connection, we need to continue to go deeper with those people, continue those conversations, show them that they can trust us. When we think about it from an ads perspective, we can do what's called retargeting. If you don't know what retargeting is, it's basically saying, once someone comes to my website or takes some specific action, I want to continue showing them a new set of ads that's going to help move them deeper into the funnel. And we'll talk about some of those ads and the type of content people are looking for at this point. Email drip campaigns. Email still works, y'all. So once you get someone and you can get them into your email list and start sending them things that are going to teach them more about you, your offering, and those problems that you solve, the more likely you are to convert them. You can also do texting if it's appropriate for your audience. And here's the one that we all hate, right? You might have to pick up the phone and call people, especially if you are in a consultative business. Now, if you're selling a simple product, something that you know is maybe under the $500 mark, then a call might not be necessary. But if you want recurring business, if you're selling a service, if you're doing anything that puts you in like a B2B space especially, you better be picking up that phone and calling these people. You might feel like you're going to annoy them, right? But how else are they going to learn more about the solution that you can provide them if you're just passively hoping that one day they'll open your email and they might decide to book a call and then maybe they'll let you tell them more and maybe one day they'll become your customer, right? We have to be direct and we have to reach out to them and say, hey, I know you're suffering from this problem. I have this great solution that's going to make your life so much easier. Let's talk about it. So what are some things that don't work for moving people into that next phase? Just hoping they'll buy. They become a lead and you're just hoping that by some magic, they learn enough on their own to buy. You're afraid to reach out directly. So we just talked about that, right? That if you have this fear around talking about your business or being very direct about your business, it's going to make your business suffer. You've got to be willing to put yourself out there and talk more. Failing to prove your credibility. So quickly, just kind of psychology lesson here with the way our brains work and the way that we build trust. When we're initially looking at solutions for our problem, right, which would be kind of our lead gen phase, as humans, we are using our what we would call like the croc brain, right? It's that part of the brain that's like right at the top of our cerebral spine that is very, very ancient in its thinking. And it's really just sort of scanning the environment for anything that can help it survive. Very rudimentary. So when we're trying to attract leads, we need to put that problem solution out there as bait, right? We're saying, hey, I know you have a problem. I can fix it. I can help you survive. I can help you win. Come talk to me and I'll teach you more. Once we get to that level of trust, then the brain is going to use more calories, more energy, more processing to move through to the neocortex and the frontal part of the brain to actually process messaging and understand more of the nuance around our offering, right? So that's why when we're just trying to generate leads, we need simple, effective messages that say what problem we can solve. When we're trying to convince them to buy from us though and move through that funnel, we need to add more nuance, and that's where we can start proving our credibility. We can tell more of our story. We can say, hey, I was where you were. I had no idea what to wear. I didn't know if the shoes matched. And so I went and took these courses and I've learned and I've had all this experience. And now I have this confidence that I can walk out of the house with every day. And I want to share that with you. I have these customers that I've helped, and you can see all of the reviews here of what I've done for them. Right? You can start to bring in that nuance and prove your credibility through sharing your story, through sharing your reviews, through showing your work. The other thing that we don't do well enough is we don't communicate our unique value. And I don't know if y'all have had any experience in developing like a unique value statement, but I have a pretty specific way of doing that, which I'm going to share with you in the next slide. We have a workbook. I'll have a slide up in a second with the link to that, where you can go through and basically define your audience, define their problems, and then create a unique value proposition or a credibility statement that they actually care about, that's really framed around the context of what they're looking for and what they need. Before I pull that up though, just one last note. If you are not using a CRM or some sort of system in your business to keep track of your leads, keep track of all of your contacts, to make sure you're, you know, doing your follow-ups, you're doing all the things that you need to with connecting with people, you are going to miss out. Your brain is going to get too full. You're going to forget about people. Things are going to slip through the cracks. So look for a CRM or a system that you can use to keep up with these people and make sure you're setting those reminders, you're doing your outreach, you're logging every note, because the more full your brain gets, the worse you get at just being able to remember off the top of your head all the important things about your connections. And that's just going to frustrate people and make them lose trust with you. So that workbook you can download at bluesteelsolutions.com/leadgen. And I'll put this back up at the end so that you guys can download it. This is a workbook that's just going to take you through really thinking about what makes you unique, what about your story, your offering makes you unique, And how does that make the solution easier or better for your customer? And so definitely, I highly encourage you to go through that, talk about it all day. So getting paid, we'll go real quickly through this one because this is just kind of my annoying things that I wanna share. So deals aren't really closed until they're funded, right? So what works, you need to make it super, super easy for people to pay you. If you can set up online payments, please do. Please let them do card and bank transfers. Checks, you know, if you're comfortable with that, that's kind of, you gotta gauge who your audience is and if they're responsible with checks, but offer credit card options and bank transfer options, especially if you're in B2B. Those guys like to just be able to do ACH, and so make it easy for them. If you do any sort of recurring, if you have a subscription, if you do recurring billing, which you should, I can do a whole other talk about recurring revenue. If you don't have a recurring revenue offering, see me after this, because you have to have that for your business to survive. You need to be billing those people on an automated basis. Do not send them invoices and hope they pay it. You need to have that automatically billing so that you know that you have revenue you can depend on. So some things that don't work, you cannot make it difficult for people to pay your invoices. I got an invoice the other day from someone where I clicked a button and then it sent me a code and then I had to put in the code and then I had to go back and like get a different thing from my inbox. And then I had to go back and then, you know, finally, after like four steps, I could put in my credit card and just pay this poor girl. Don't make it that difficult, right? Like if someone else wants to magically access that link and pay my invoice for me, who cares? Let them pay it. Don't make me go through hoops just to pay your invoice. This is my personal pet peeve. Do not charge people additional for credit card fees. Okay, I sell $20,000 websites, and if someone pays for it with a credit card, I'm going to eat that cost because it is a cost of doing business, and I've already built the fee into the pricing of my solution. It's a quick way to show people that you are newbie and that you are very scared of paying for anything and investing in your business, or at least that's how I see it. So just build that cost into what you're doing. A lot of credit card companies actually have it in their terms of service that you cannot do that. You cannot charge a fee for people to use credit cards. So you might not only be looking kind of like you don't know what you're doing to your customers, but also you could be getting yourself in trouble with credit card processing. Don't manually bill those recurring fees. All right, so one last section that I want to get through as quickly as we can here. Is what happens after you get paid. This is the money, right? This is what everyone forgets about. Because once you get paid, right, you are not done. This is not the end of the life cycle. You absolutely need to think about what happens after the sale. You need to keep your customers, right? You need to get referrals. You need to get reviews from them. And you need to sell to them again and again and again and again. So the first thing that you need to do to work, to make this post-sale process work for you, is you have to provide an exceptional solution, right? If you are not being the problem solver, if you are not actually fixing something that's wrong in their lives, whether it be a tiny little annoyance in their day-to-day life or something incredibly important like their own mental health image, then you're not going to be able to continue to sell to them and get the reviews and referrals that you want. You also need to have recurring offers. Even if you sell a product, no matter what you do, you have to be able to get people onto a recurring revenue pattern. Without doing that, that means you have to work your butt off for every single sale. But if you can get someone into a subscription, into, you know, a recurring offering, then you only have to work your butt off once to get that sale and then keep them really happy, right? So that they continue to pay you, they continue to have their card charged every month, and you continue to build more and more business while having money that just comes in while you're sleeping. There's nothing better than that. And then you also need to think about those upsell and cross-sell offers. So by keeping your audience really narrow and saying, I solve problems for this specific type of person, then it's really easy for you to come up with other things that they need. You can come up with other upsells. You can sell them similar services or things that are going to, you know, help go along with your primary service or solution. And then that way you can keep one audience and continue to sell to them. I know. So then you also need to ask for reviews and referrals. It can be awkward to ask for those, right? But if you've provided an exceptional solution, then you can feel really confident in asking for a review. You can feel really confident in saying, hey, I had the best experience working with you. We're a fit, and I want to work with more people just like you. So if you have friends, if you have colleagues, if you have anyone that you know is suffering from the same problem that you were, could you give them my information, or could you give me their name and I'll reach out to them? You've got to be willing to have those conversations with the people who have already purchased from you. And I mean, specific customers. So what doesn't work, you cannot just stop when they pay. You've got to continue selling to them. And that doesn't have to mean selling to them in a slimy way. It means that you continue to have other offerings for them and you continue to really wow them so that you can get their business over and over. And also, right, repeat customers, way better ROI in the long term than trying to bring in new customers all the time. And again, highlighting their wins. So this is going to help you build trust with new prospects that are coming in. So when you share a review from a customer, you're not gonna say, look how awesome they think we are. You're gonna say, look at this amazing thing that my client and dear friend so-and-so did in their life because we were able to guide them to this solution, right? You're gonna continue to frame their wins instead of yours so that you build trust with new prospects that are coming in and get them into your lead funnel so that eventually you can share their story and highlight their win as well. Okay, so that was a lot of information in a very short period of time, but I hope that you were able to get some good ideas to kind of understand more about what you need to be doing to get people from interest all the way through to buying and then buying from you over and over again. So I have a few websites here. Blue Steel Solutions is kind of our primary offering where we do websites, content writing, maintenance. We also have a lot of resources on that website that you can download and use in your business. For people that are just getting started and need kind of more of a DIY approach, we have our problemsolvermethod.com. And then for businesses that are ready to take it to the next level, they're really looking for someone to take on the CMO role and offer them a comprehensive marketing strategy to follow, we have our valuebuildingmarketing.com. Does anyone need the website address again for the workbook? Okay, I'm going to go back to that in just a second. I'll leave this up so you guys can write this down and I'll go back. I think though we're ready to start taking questions, if there are any.
Yeah, so also really quick, I believe Heather, there should be on our YouTube channel, we had the special event where you did a whole talk on the subscription services.
Yes.
I believe it was 2020. We did it during COVID. We're looking for ways for other
you guys need to watch it because I'm literally in my garage because it was the only quiet place away from my children.
Yes, I remember
the production quality, not so great, but the content I think is pretty good.
Yeah. And it was a lot of great information.
Yeah.
Again, we're looking for ways to, you know, give people an opportunity to create additional revenue. So I don't know. The slides, you'll be able to get these on the replay as well as, I don't know if we can
go back. I have them on that link. This little wheel is so sensitive. We kept bumping it the whole time. There we go. Okay, so that bluesteelsolutions.com/lead gen. You can get this workbook. Also, the slides are available there. And then if you explore our website, especially under the resources tab, there's just tons of information. You can also on any page on our website get on our email list, which will send you lots of useful stuff and some maybe not so useful, but interesting information. So I'd love to have you join us there as well.
Awesome. So Stephanie, you want to give us an online question?
Yes, I would love to. We do have several questions on our end. We'll get to as many as we can, ladies. First question is, I understand the processing fees. What about charging tax on services? Most charge a flat fee, but what is the preferred method?
Ooh, ask your accountant, not me. has specific rules for what services are taxable and what are not taxable. And I have to trust my accountant that we're doing ours right. So
yeah,
ask someone who's a tax specialist about that. Good question. Pay your taxes.
All right, so a question in here. Does somebody have a question?
Just double checking. Okay, I have two actually. One's very quick. How do you feel about automated responses? Like for those of us, like if I'm a wedding planner and I work weekends, is there studies or something to say whether someone that inquired on our website prefers an immediate response, telling them, hey, we're not available right now, XYZ, or what I do, which I would love to know is right, is we wait, personalize it until we're actually at our computer.
So I would take advantage of the immediate response because you want to address the solution you provide right when they're thinking about the problem. If you wait even a few hours, then they've moved on to the next problem in their life, right? So if you can get them that automated response, but then don't just say, we'll get back with you on Monday. Say, and here's some stories from our recent events. Here's some pictures of what we've done. You know, add that to the bottom of that email, more context, and start selling them there. That way they can really start to visualize how you can help them. Anything you can put into that email that makes you unique from other people they're researching, because you know they're not just hitting your website. They're going to hit several others. So whatever you can put into that email that's going to be an immediate, oh, wow, they're different. You might even want to think about a video message that you can put into the email so they get something back and says, hey, we're busy making someone's day the most wonderful day of their life. We'll get back to you on Monday. But here's a quick minute and a half on us and what we do and put a little portfolio reel together and a very personalized message. I think that would be an awesome way to keep them engaged.
Love it.
Yeah, and not just, because by the time Monday comes around, like somebody might have already sold them, right? You never know.
Awesome. All right, Stephanie, another online question?
I do. The next question is, let's see. Also, my question is, if she has any tips specifically for B2B solutions for marketing for leads. Any specific tips on B2B solution for marketing lead for marketing for leads?
Okay, so B2B is still pretty general. So without knowing like what industry or what kind of solution you have, you know, I would say really these same rules still apply. LinkedIn is a great place to do research. I do a lot of direct outreach through LinkedIn. It has to be done in a way that's not spammy and annoying. But if you can reach out and start connecting with your ideal prospects directly through LinkedIn, you can cut through a lot of the clutter. But again, you got to lead with that solution and you've got to do it in a way that's not going to startle, you know, the basal ganglia and make it feel like you're threatening it. You have to really approach it in a more, you don't want to sound like the spammers, right? You don't want to send like this long block of text. I don't know if you guys get those all the time, but I do. That's like, everybody sends the exact same one. You really want to start a conversation, ask them about the problems that they're facing, and then start to introduce your solution. Otherwise, you know, there's a million different ways to get leads. You can do networking, you can go to trade shows, you can buy lists and start to try to warm those up. So I'd need to know more context around their business to be able to give a better answer.
That's a great answer though, because I'm going to start when they spam me in my LinkedIn. I'm going to tell them, I think you need to reach out to Heather Steele.
I do send them, but I have a canned message that I copy and send back. It's like, ask them, does this ever work for you?
Yeah.
And they're usually like, no, I'm so frustrated. And I'm like, okay, well, here's the program we use.
Yeah.
But
they probably connect and try to sell me like that. I'm like,
yeah, oh, it's crazy. It's
question.
I do. When you're asking after you're done, you've made the sale, you did the job, and you want a referral or a review, do people still do surveys or mail back cards? Like, I want it to be authentic, not that they're just saying, sure, I'll tell everybody you did a great job to my face and then not behind my back.
Definitely. Yeah. You can use third-party services for that. So especially with you know, in healthcare, and dealing with like a more fragile situation, I suggest the third party thing okay. where it's a little bit more anonymous and they don't feel like, man, if I tell her she was terrible, like she knows where my mom lives. Like, this is going to be bad. You could use a third party. You could set up a survey on your website.
Okay.
One thing I do too, especially for long engagements, we're working together over a long period of time, is I will set up a survey that I send people to periodically. So I'll have a survey on my website and I'll say, hey, you know, we've been working together for 3 months now. Can you just go fill this in? Tell me, you know, how it's going. And I have a blog post linked to that survey that basically explains, like, I want you to hurt my feelings. Mm-hmm. I want you to tell me everything I'm doing wrong so I can make this better. And like, I've been doing this long enough that it's, you're not going to ruin our relationship. You're going to make it better. And so I think framing it around that too, that, hey, whatever you say, like, I'm a big girl, I can handle it. Let's just get the real feedback. The other thing I would add to that is when you are sending a survey at the end of an engagement, if you think that there's any chance that, you know, they weren't so happy, don't ask for a review at the same time. Wait until you get the positive survey back and then say, oh, I'm so glad you were happy. Like, could you share your thoughts here?
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. All right, Stephanie, we have another online question.
We do. Let's see. Are there any past recordings that for your presentations? You mentioned a subscription recording.
Yeah, so that's on our YouTube channel, and I will make sure that I include the link to that when I send out the replay and everything for that folder. I'll make sure all that is there so you can connect with Heather and learn about that.
Sorry, I just realized I forgot to tell my son's school that we'd be late today. So I'm
all right,
right now. Let me just send this and then I will. I was like, oh, it starts at 7:30. We'll be fine. Oh, yeah, it doesn't end at 7:30.
Mom problems.
Yeah.
We've all been there.
The struggle is real.
Okay. Done. All right. Can you repeat the question?
So she wanted a recording about the email solution. Oh, yes. So I told her we would send it out with this replay. I'll link it to our YouTube so that they can go back and look at that.
And if you will, on my website, just scroll to the bottom of any page and get on our email list. Those recordings that I've done outside of TWU are also things that go out like in our introductory messages. So if you get on that list over the coming, several weeks, you'll get access to a lot of that stuff from me too.
Awesome. Yes, ma'am.
I have just heard mixed things about, like, since Facebook changed like their terms about the targeted ads. Do you have mm-hmm. any tips on how to reach those specifically?
So it has gotten more difficult to target people. A lot of the demographic data that we used to be able to target on with ads is no longer available. What I think is the most helpful is to create audiences based on the type of content they interact with and like. So by that I mean, I was helping someone recently that offers services to churches, right? And so we looked at, okay, the kind of churches that you work with, let's sort of create a profile of those people and what they're interested in. And we found that almost all of them are NPR supporters. And so we were able to create audience groups that are based on not only like their interest groups outside of like the church, because that's really hard to target on. But we were able to create a group based on people that like a certain NPR membership page. So we know they're NPR donors, they kind of fit our profile. And so let's create an audience there and then start adding back in demographics that we can access. So that's one way to do that. Another way is to take a list that you know is a really good list for you, maybe of your past clients, and upload that as a lookalike audience. So then Facebook will find people that have similar profiles to them that have similar interest groups. It has gotten harder to target people as specifically, but if you get kind of creative about, okay, like what other things are they interested in? You know, what other pages that might they like? We helped a dog shampoo company. And so we targeted people who are interested in like Chewy.com and PetSmart.com. And so that was one way to kind of narrow them down a little bit more.
Awesome, great question. Stephanie, do we have any more online questions?
I do have one more. How many emails should you have in your automated string before you say, okay, buy this at this price?
I think you should be telling them to buy from the get-go, but that's my personal experience. A PS line is a great place to sneak in a call to action. You can have an email that's got great info, you know, build your story, talks about the solution, and then you can throw in the PS line, hey, if this sounds like you, click here to get started, or whatever that might be. And then over time, as you're getting more engagement with them, you can make that call to action a bit stronger. But we're here to sell, right? It's no secret. Like, you get on an email list, you know that they're selling to you. Even if they're sending you the sweetest, most wonderful email that seems to have nothing to do with their product or their service, they're selling you something. So putting a call to action at the end of an email, even if it's the very first one, I don't have a problem with it. If they don't like it, right? If they're like, oh, they're trying to sell me something, you don't want them on your list anyway, because they're never going to buy from you.
Yeah, you want them to unsubscribe, right?
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Don't waste your time.
All right. Another question in person. Yes, ma'am.
I just have a question. Kind of similar to what she was asking, like, about the survey.
Mm-hmm.
But in the health field, you know, we have to be concerned about HIPAA. And I was just wondering if you have any suggestions when getting reviews, how maybe a different way to go about doing that.
So with reviews, you know, I'm not a HIPAA expert. I know we've got several medical providers that still do reviews, because I think with HIPAA, like a patient can release their own information. And so what I would do, and definitely feel free to check this with a third party that actually knows HIPAA laws better than I do. I would direct them to something like Google reviews or your Facebook reviews, so that it's completely external, and you're not posting it on your website. You're not the one that's sharing it. They are. And then when you're sharing those reviews, you can say, look at our Facebook page and all of our reviews. We have 5 stars on Google. You know, here's the link where you can read those. So if you keep it outside of your control, then I think that's okay. But again, I would definitely ask someone who has more experience with HIPAA. But I know we have many clients that do it that way and never had a problem.
What about having them review right when they're at their location?
Yeah, I mean, if it's appropriate
to.
Or
whatever they say and say, can I put this on my site? You know, can I?
Definitely, if you're not in a HIPAA violation type of situation, super appropriate. Yeah, I have a colleague who's so smart about that. She does a call after every new marketing launch or website launch, just to kind of find out how it's going with the client. And she records the calls. And if the client says something about how happy they are, she goes, do you mind if I pull that little piece out and just add it to my portfolio? And of course, they're like, yes, go for it. And she gets these amazing, like, completely, you know, unprompted, just very pure reviews that she can use. So that's a super smart way of doing things.
But don't forget to ask if you can record the conversation.
Yeah. Yes.
We're all too pretty for... You know, that was anyway, I digress. Do we have any more questions in person? Cindy?
I have a question about that. You mentioned you asked for the sale, but I know social media was one of the leads. So if we're constantly, let's just say like 3 times a week, we're posting to social media, should we be, like, I have heard the 80-20 rule before. Mm-hmm. So should I be like sharing my knowledge of all of the wedding ins and outs and then maybe once a week saying, hey, by the way, we offer a free consult call, click the link here. I don't do it every time, but is that, should I be?
So if you're offering a free consult, I don't consider that selling. I mean, I don't think there's a problem with reminding people about that consult, especially if you're pairing it with really helpful information. Now I would say, I would not spend 80% of the time on those educating kind of giving type posts. I would share more of stories, experiences, pictures, the outcomes, right? The tips and tricks type stuff is really important. But again, you will burn yourself out on trying to educate people, giving them information, spoon feeding them everything. This is how we used to try to market our business, with so many free resources. And it didn't work. We stopped doing that. In fact, when you go into our resource center, there's only like 2 things that are free now. We charge for everything else because What we found is that people who get free information do nothing with it, or they do the bare minimum, and then they blame you when it didn't work, right?
Yeah.
And so it creates this horrible like cycle of now you've got people that want stuff for free from you, they're not going to implement it well, and then they're going to be mad at you because it didn't work. And so it's like, not only are you not making money, you're just like sinking into a hole. So just side note of 80% of your time should be spent on things that are not direct calls to action, sharing other people's content, you know, maybe your other vendors that you use, you know, helping promote them, but share more experiences, stories, you know, show the problems that you've solved for people. Don't feel like you have to educate all the time, because you don't. It's not your job. It's not your job to tell people how you do what you do. It's your job to show people what problems you can solve for them and then let them pay you for your expertise. Yeah.
Awesome. Any more questions online, Stephanie?
Nope, not at this time. Thank you so much for answering our questions. We really appreciate it.
Yeah. Okay, so I'm going to stop sharing. And I think at this time, we're going to go, let me stop recording.